We are the painters of our world. We are creators. We decide what.
As you heard from the previous panel, there's a lot of the lingering impacts of Brown versus Board. Trayshawn, we'll start with you.
Yes,
as a Black and African American student at California Community College, I want you to think about those who, the Thurgood Marshalls and the NAACP, and those who fought for the opportunity that we have today and the discussion that we're having 70 years later for Brown versus Board.
You know, I have to say, by the grace of God, their work has not went in vain. And I believe we're living testimonies of that right now, including yourself, that we are pursuing higher education. We are doing great things. We are great people, and we will continue to soar and move forward. So earlier, listening to California Secretary of the State, Dr. Weber, and the panel, I just want to say thank you to them for speaking on the topic of Brown versus the Board of Education. And for me personally, it just reinforced for me to continue pushing forward, because someone has to take their spots. I just want to say thank you to them for weathering the storm, so young people like ourselves can be where we are now and eventually take their position and be leaders for the generation of tomorrow.
And I believe it was Dr. Weber who mentioned about education being, nobody could take education away from you. Because at the end of the day, once you have that knowledge, you're pretty much powerful.
There's been a lot of attacks on diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives. There's rolling back of affirmative action. Context of Brown versus Board, what can colleges and districts do more to be more prevalent in asserting and centering our students of color, particularly Black students?
At the community college I went to, when I first started going there, I didn't know of any programs that were geared towards serving Black and African American students. But I think there has been progress in terms of changing and working towards diversity, inclusion, and equity. And it's that, you know, like, I still work at the community college that I graduated from. And just in this last year or so, like, they've hired a Black student success counselor. Right? Like, being able to see yourself in the people who are working at the college is important. So I think that's progress, them bringing that in as an addition to diversity and equity and inclusion. Like Black Student Success Week, like really making that like a big deal on campus. Being able to see that happening is showing that growth, that bridging the gap, like bringing it back, you know, to, hey, like everyone here is welcome. Everyone here should be included. And progress has been made. And they are doing more to include Black and African American students. But, you know, I think there's still a lot more that we're working towards, and it's possible. It's going to happen.
Now I want to kind of have everyone tackle on, and we'll start with you, is this idea of, can you be your authentic self? Can you be your Black authentic self? And have you been able to do that in your self-discovery journey in college?
I'm learning to be. Mm-hmm. I don't think that I thought that I could be my authentic self, but then like I started doing the work that I do, like advocacy and just like what I'm doing, I'm like, why can't I? Why can't I be my authentic self? So I would say that I'm learning.
Mm-hmm. On the college campus, I feel that I can partially be me. Mm. We have to code switch sometimes. The way that I talk when I'm in Del Paso Heights is not the way I'm going to talk when I'm on the ARC campus handling business. It's just two different environments. So you have to know how to carry yourself in both environments, which is really important.
It takes a lot of mental burden, though, you know, to kind of code switch and be in that dual consciousness W.E. Du Bois mentions, right? Like knowing how to navigate, even for asking for resources, right? Am I going to feed into a stereotype for saying that I do have a food insecurity, that I am hungry and raising my hand? Or is the resource supposed to be advertised to me so I can properly engage that food pantry in that college district and whatnot?
It is hard for me to feel like I can be my authentic self, or to speak my truth, or from being a victim to a survivor. Like, yeah, I agree that we all have choices, but in my personal experience, it's like the environment that I'm in also impacts that.
And how much of that is also predicated on representation, having someone that looks like you, reaching out to you. Anyone want to tackle that on?
Los Angeles Southwest College, from my perspective, that is like a big shift from Brown and versus Board of Education, because it is mostly Black students. It's a lot of Black professors, you know, and the president of our college is Black. The dean of students is Black. And it's just so inspiring, and it's powerful to be in that, just surrounding that environment.
When I see like an African-American person in like a very, very high position, it inspires me like, oh, I can do that too. Like I could get there too. I have gotten help from people that are not African-American, and they gave me the same amount, not the same amount, but like a sort of motivation, like a type of motivation. But when I see someone that looks like me in a position, it's just different.
You know, our youth and ourselves as well, we can't be what we can't see.
Mm.
You know, so it's important.
Say that again, one more time.
We cannot be what we can't see. Mm. And you can't lead where you won't go. So it's important that we are in those positions. It's important for our students to speak up as well. You know, some of our Black and African American peers come from families that have never attended college. They don't know how to process what they're going through. And they can't go home and really talk about it because the family won't understand. They've never been to college. They don't understand the stressors of that. So it's important to be a part of something to get that support that you need so you can continue to move forward in your studies.
And Daniel, you being a wealth of life experiences to your experience as a community college student.
Life throw you curveballs, man. So like for me, I had 3 back surgeries. Didn't expect it. And as a college student, you know, most college students, they get on that routine. I call it a routine where you just show up to class, go through your lecture. Most college students, they're on that routine cycle. So it's very important to be involved because it builds a support net. So when I first touched down on campus, when it opened up, it was a culture shock because like I didn't see nobody that looked like me until I linked in with Dr. Sims. And then he got me together with the men's program, and I started seeing more brothers that looked like me. I started seeing more African-American women, and I started learning who the African-American faculty was and things like that. It's a lot of stuff I didn't even know about until, like I said, becoming a part of a men's and going to different conferences and going and visit different campuses and seeing, you know, the African-American students on that campus and talk about the things that they're going on and different things that's available to us as African-American students. Like, I didn't know any of this stuff. Even growing up, when I was in high school, a lot of us didn't pursue higher education because we didn't have the information that we needed to pursue that. Like, we didn't know anything about how to go about filling out a FAFSA. We didn't know about, you know, looking up different scholarships and different grants, and we didn't know about that stuff. So, which left a lot of us to go right back to the community and get into things that didn't mean us no good.
Being a young 18-year-old father, you know, graduate, you know, I didn't have a vehicle or anything at the time. But once I enrolled at American River College, they gave me an ID, and they gave me a bus sticker. And I rode that bus to school. I rode the 15 and I rode the 86 from Del Paso Heights to American River College to get my education to better myself and change the trajectory of my life and also my daughter's life. But once I got on campus, I learned about the Learning Resource Center. I learned about the Writing Center. I learned about the Math Lab. Coming out of high school, I struggled with writing. I struggled with math. And it was like, man, I don't know if I should be here or should I do something else? But I stepped through the doors of the math lab. I stepped through the doors of the writing center, and there were tutors there on standby. Welcomed me. Hey, you need some help? What you working on? Come on, let's get you in here. Come on, let's do this. You can do this. If you put in the time and believe in yourself, you can do it. Because I started out doing remedial math, which was the bottom of the barrel at the time. It's like, okay, how am I going to get here to the stats class I need so I can qualify for a nursing program? I just did not know how I was going to get there. But through the math lab and that being an option, by the grace of God, look at me now.
You want to add to that?
Yeah, I'm only 20. And so I'm new to the college experience, but there are college students that are 65, college students that are 35, 45, college students that are coming back after years of not going to school, but wanting better for themselves. And so it could be a very difficult transition. And so there are times where mental health is out there and therapy is out there. There are so many people on my campus that don't even know that there is even a mental health office. There are people that don't even know that there is a student organization office. But there's so many opportunities that are able to help. But if you don't know, then you're going to just be stuck in the same old cycle. So,
and this is important because one of the things that Brown versus Board really fought for was the allocation of resources, these, you know, equitizing that opportunity for folks. So folks may not know about a mental health clinic at the campus. And there's a lot of trauma that we are engaged in as a community. And so if we're truly gonna be a community college and holistically support the student, these things matter. Yet there's still things that are preventing us from seeking help or raising our hand.
Knowing that those resources are there is important. Knowing who to connect with and who to talk to about those resources is extremely important.
I know for myself, being a disabled veteran and dealing with things like PTSD and stuff like that and going through different counselors and stuff like that, of course, being a minority, you're always going to feel comfortable talking to somebody that looks like you. And I think that's just something that's natural. You're always going to feel comfortable around people that looks like you or, you know, same color skin or whatever the case may be. But I've talked to people that don't look like me and I've walked away with so much information, you know. So I think color isn't the big issue. It's just about how do we get this information and get it out? How do we change the dynamic? We're pushing mental health. You need to go speak to a counselor. We got counselors here. If you need to sit down and talk to somebody about something that you're going through, we got that. If you want to learn more about PTSD, anxiety, and how to overcome, we got that information.
Absolutely. Come over to you. I know you're an advocate for a lot of challenges and issues that many of our African-American students may be dealing with, particularly around socioeconomic distress, advocacy for foster youth, formerly incarcerated. What is your experience like and how has your advocacy impacted your college experience?
In my experience, like, you just kind of got to go and like find the resources that kind of like make you a family, or like the programs that make you a family. So for me, it would be like Next Step, EOPS.
Can you explain to folks what the Next Step program is?
So the Next Step program is a program for former foster youth, and they help with a variety of different things throughout college. They help with books. Me personally, I got my phlebotomy license through my Next Step counselor because she looked up schools for me. Now, I'm not going to say all of them are going to go that far, but mine did. They have snacks. I always got to shout out the snacks because, like, college is hard and you be hungry.
Food insecurity is real. Homelessness is real. There's a lot of students that maybe listen to this podcast and maybe on the fence of why California Community College. You mentioned the BSUs, the Emojis, the Veterans Resource Centers, the Next Ups, the EOPS, the DSS, dual enrollment, which is an opportunity for high school students, HBCU tours, and HBCU associate degree transfers. So many, a plethora of resources that California Community Colleges offers, certifications that you've received to work, being a parent, you know, and still being able to be successful. For those students who are on the fence today about why they should look at the California Community Colleges and see this as a beacon of success and light of hope, what would you say to them?
First and foremost, I want to say, I believe in you, but you must believe in yourself. And if you want it, go get it. You can do it. I'm a living, walking, talking example and testimony. You know, I came out of Del Paso Heights. I'm a Grant High School graduate. I struggled, you know, in school, but once I got to college, you know, I was given assistance and at the DSPS office of how to study and how to attack these different classes because it was a little overwhelming. But there are resources on the campus. You just have to believe in yourself, step foot on the campus, ask for what you need, and go for it. You can do it.
Community college and the college experience, you go to find yourself. You go to learn who you are, to find your passions. No matter what it may be, you may change your degree 5 times. You know, it's all about connecting, networking, making lifelong partnerships with people, building something, doing something that's greater than yourself. You know, opportunities are everywhere. You also got to be ready for when those opportunities come, because if you're not, then you miss out. And I know it's very advertised to go straight to the 4-year and to do that. But, you know, 2 years free. And you get first priority when you transfer.
and you have a better chance of going into the institutions once you go through community college.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The transfer programs, the opportunity to explore a little bit, make your decision, be more decisive, have some college experience. And then at 20, 21 or 2 years in, you're able to make a better decision at 17, 18.
And most of them are smaller than the universities, which means that there are much more resources.
Correct.
And much more, there's much more things that are catered to that specific community than at a university where it's managing thousands and tens of thousands of students. So
I feel like community colleges is like the basic training to the university level. Yeah. That's gonna train you and give you the discipline that you need to withstand and to support yourself once you get to the 4-year level. So any student that's coming out of high school or questioning, oh, why should I go to community college or why should I do this? Because you're investing in yourself, for one. And for two, it's the perfect place to start. Like, you don't have to spend a whole lot of money, as to where if you go into straight into a 4-year, you forking out that money, I'll walk through the door. That's the first part right there. Once you get through the door, the rest of it is easy. Mm-hmm. It may seem hard, but once you walk through that door, once you go over that, the rest of it is downhill from there. You got to find it in yourself to believe in yourself and say, hey, I'm going to go through this door and I'm going to do this like he did. Like all of us sitting up here did. Like, that's the first step, going through the door.
Tanil, what would you tell to those students, particularly those you always consistently advocate for, that don't think that they're college worthy or this system wasn't designed for them to succeed? What would you tell them?
Definitely that knowledge is power. That's one thing that nobody could take away from you, no matter how hard they try or what they do. And also, like, they kind of don't want you to do it, so prove them wrong. You can do it.
I want to just thank you all for your insights, your perspectives, sharing and pouring your heart into this work. I know that sometimes we think of the work of our ancestors and how we carry that mantle for the future and the legacy, and I see you all playing a pivotal role in that. And to the audience, knowing that, you know, we all have ears, some of us can hear and some of us can listen, I hope that they listen, and I just heard what you said. Listening requires organs, requires the heart and the mind. We all have eyes, some of us can see, some of us can envision. Or we can envision what our ancestors and those who fought for Brown versus Board can envision to see us being successful in navigating higher education, to having that access, to having these resources. We all, as you mentioned, you know, going through COVID, we all have hands. Some of us can touch and some of us can feel. I hope that we can feel. When you hug somebody, you feel that person. I feel you, you know? I just touch the person, you feel them. So I hope that they feel your energy, that you feel your passion, your commitment. And thank you all for just thinking of you being a prayer answered and something bigger than yourself.
We are the painters of